Today on Monster News, Charlie and Haley prepare to watch The Creature from the Black Lagoon trilogy back to back to back. As you can see, Charlie is undergoing a vigorous training regimen. Of course, it helps when your personal trainer is your wife, am I right, fellas? Indeed, his training is going swimmingly. Meanwhile, on the Universal lot, I mean Brazil, Gilman is taking it easy. He also sings sometimes. It's kind of weird. Will Charlie and Haley be able to handle the task?
Is that the Wolfman cane?
No,
I want that cane.
Focus.
I want the cane.
Focus.
Find out.
Hi, welcome to Monster Vlogs. I'm Charlie.
I'm Haley.
And we have begun our journey, our trek, our odyssey.
Our expedition.
Expedition into the unknown depths of the Amazonian jungle lagoons with Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Ta-da!
1954. Starring
Richard Carlson.
And Richard Denning. And of course the lovely, lovely Julie Adams.
Julie Adams. Yes.
Not that kind of Adams. But
Wendy.
Describing what this movie is about is really not important. You know.
There is a fish man.
They meet
the fish man on a scientific expedition.
And, you know, this is your typical atomic age film. We are now officially in the atomic age. We are in the 1950s. We have broken out of the 40s. And this is where films kind of have a pretty set formula.
It definitely seems to have worked out a lot of the kinks that were inherent in the 30s and 40s horror films.
Like, well, this is literally an entirely different beast.
Right. But you feel like there's more of a streamlinedness, there's more of a finesse to filmmaking now.
Obviously production quality isn't exactly as high as it was in the 20s and 30s and the 40s.
It became easier to get what would be considered high in the 20s and 30s.
Right.
It's kind of like how home video a decade ago was much different than home video now.
I mean, people weren't so much shooting on studios as they were kind of going off studios and shooting at other people's studios. Shooting around the world because this wonderful invention called television hit the scene. And they were trying to compete with it in as many ways as possible. You couldn't see anything like this on TV because it was presented in theaters in 3D. Glorious, glorious red and cyan. those are good times. But
this is classy 3D.
This is classy 3D. I mean, this is a pretty classy movie, all things considered.
They don't chuck anything in your face unless, you know, the story calls for it.
Subtle. Yeah. Incredibly subtle. Like this, I hate to say it, but this was the Avatar of its day.
I get that feeling.
I mean, there are just so many things to talk about with this movie. Like, obviously the plot, it's so cookie cutter. Just look up any 1950s movie plot that has to deal with science versus nature.
I do think it has some differences between, like, them and this one. Because it's not, you know,
it's not something science created.
Yes, it's not something science created. Something it accidentally discovered.
Well, that is another common theme in, like, this era of film. Where science discovers something and it ends up wanting to kill them, or some creature has been unearthed by science meddling with nature. I mean, Godzilla. And there's really no other perfect example than that.
It's interesting that the two main scientists have very differing views on it. One's like, we have to capture it and bring it back because it's a great find.
Nobody will believe us.
We gotta prove to the world
even though we have a freaking
fossilized hand!
That we did the thing. We have to prove that we did the thing. We have to, you know, monetize the thing and merchandise the thing. Prove we did the thing.
And
the
other you're selling ones... it. You're selling it. You did draw a lot of comparisons to Jurassic Park in this film.
There are quite, like, especially the way that the monster is handled and the way that the first act is so monster-free.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's barely about the monster in the first act and even part of the second act. And the monster just very abruptly comes in, but he's alluded to the entire time. And you see a lot of Jaws in that, and you see a lot of Jurassic Park in that. I wouldn't be surprised if this was Spielberg's favorite monster movie.
More than likely, yeah.
Because it's that way of, okay, this is this wild animal that's decided it doesn't like you and it's going to kill you whether
you think you
can stop it or not.
It's interesting that you mentioned Spielberg and this may being his speech, it escapes me, and this possibly being his favorite film. Because as I was looking up how the creature's roar was created, because it's very like the sound effect of the winch that's on the boat.
Mm-hmm. But it also reminds me of the raptors in Jurassic Park. It's this very unnatural, like, guttural noise.
Sort of almost lion-esque
lion
roar.
Meets a gator bellow. If you've ever heard a gator bellow.
Honestly, that's probably what they did, just combine the two.
Mm-hmm.
Now that I think about it.
Because gator bellow is like this really low... I'm doing it justice. Insert gator bellow there. It doesn't sound like that.
No.
It's like literally like it's the sound is sitting in the pit of its stomach and he's just like hissing out danger.
Yeah.
And when you look it up, you'll hear.
Yeah.
But this had like more action-y growl like a lion to it.
But the way that Spielberg used it was in his film Duel. As the sound of the truck engine. It is a very distorted Gilman roar. And I find that...
reference.
It, like, that's an interesting aside.
Yeah.
That has absolutely nothing to do with this film, but that just proves that this film has some weight to it. This
mm-hmm.
film has some, like, a legacy behind it.
They put effort into this film.
This film...
This is effort I have not seen since the big ones.
Yeah, and there's a reason Gilman has stuck around and been inducted into this pantheon of Universal monsters.
So many tense moments in this film. Because whenever you see them go underwater...
Oh, yeah, tension immediately
gets... They're beautiful underwater shots. First time, 90% of their first underwater scene, nothing happens. And then all of a sudden it's like... Gilman! Which...
His reveal is borderline jump scare.
It's very startling. It definitely startled me. I was like, that's interesting. That's new! And then you just start dreading every time they go into the water.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's like, okay, when's it going to hit? When's it gonna hit?
Oh yes, like it's exactly like you said. It is very much structured like Jaws at that point. Like
mm-hmm.
as soon as you see Gilman, everything changes. It's like the Fire Nation attacking. It's just like all of that.
They don't even show Gilman for his first kills.
No.
When he attacks the camp while everyone's gone,
exactly.
You just see his hand just
you
like
just
grab
see his
people's
hand
faces.
And his feet. And it's just this, and his design, okay, we got to talk about his design.
Bud you're amazing.
Westmore.
Bud Westmore. If you watch Face Off at all, you know him because his daughter, Mackenzie Westmore, hosts it. And he's often a mentor on that show.
And, I mean, he's up there with Jack Pierce
as
one of the greats.
Yes, he's the new Jack Pierce at this point in time for Universal.
And, you know, like, how would you describe Gilman's design? Because I said that the entire suit is very much suited to be an effective swimsuit. Because the feet are flippers
mm-hmm.
and, you know, they have the fins
and
the hands.
Webbing.
So,
and it doesn't really impede the suit actor's swimming at all.
No.
I
think there are a couple interviews with the swimming actor, because there were two different actors who played Gilman. One in the water, one on land.
Mm-hmm.
And the swimming actor, I mean, God bless this guy. He had to hold his breath for like several minutes at a time just to get these shots. Because, I mean, even the shot, we'll get to the shots later, were like a feat all their own.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these were some of the most impressive underwater filming techniques ever at this point.
They wouldn't be matched until Jaws.
They would not be matched until Jaws. But, like, the overall design, because obviously his face is very fish-like.
Yes, it's very fish-like. Everything else is very reptilian, though.
Yeah, the sidings of his body are very much like...
There are ridges on his back that really remind me of a gator.
Yeah, he's like half gator, half man, half fish. Do the math. But...
I did.
I know. So he's like a 1.5 man or creature.
Aesthetically, it's very intuitive. But I feel like aesthetically, I feel like it would need a tail, but that would impede his swimming. So, and it's very...
Funny you mention that, because I did actually find an item on eBay for a possible remake of this. I mean, a remake has been talked about for years. Obviously, that one remake that happened at Universal Studios Hollywood, we will not talk about
down
here.
Down boy, down boy.
Because I already did.
You watched the good movie. Link
I
here.
Did. There's a link in the description for that video. You can really understand it without context. But anyway, there's a statuette that I found on eBay. It's mm-hmm. going for like an insane price because it's being sold at an amazing store.
Yeah.
It's like 24 inches tall, and like this Gill Man is very much like the 54 Gill Man. But he has that tail, like...
He has this beautiful, long, like, iguana alligator tail that like, just extends and... Oh, it's gorgeous.
Very, very much, like, honoring that gator aspect mm-hmm. to the design.
And I'm from Mississippi, okay? I appreciate the aesthetic form of an alligator. I've gotten to hold baby gators before, okay? They're adorable.
So, I mean, the design is great, even though it is very... kind of hokey and still very much 50s.
The face is very hokey to me. The body, like, it's incredibly intuitive, but the face, I'm just like, wouldn't be a fish, be a reptile, give it teeth.
Uh-huh.
I know it's a gill man, but it's not a fish. Killing me here.
But it's a lungfish, dear. They go on and on about lungfish.
They stretch, like, to nothing.
To be fair?
To try and justify Gilman's existence, which kudos for trying.
It was the 50s.
I know, but they're trying to say lungfish, which are native to Africa or in the Amazon, and that lungfish, the capacity for lungs, are this big missing link between sea animals and land animals when amphibians are the big missing link. And it was all just to explain how Gilman could get there.
Yeah.
It was all just set up to say, Gill Man exists. We're going to stretch these tensions of facts until your disbelief is suspended.
Oh, you know what we haven't talked about?
What?
The beginning of the movie. How it describes the beginning. How Earth was created.
How it
created.
Kind of smushes together Genesis and evolution. Genesis and
the Rite of Spring segment in Fantasia.
Little footprints on sand. Little fishy footprints.
Shot pretty close to here, like on the beaches of LA.
Mm.
On one of the beaches, Will Rogers State Beach. Okay, like, we could gush about this movie forever and ever and ever. There are some incredible shots in this.
There's the shot of Gilman, like, in that little cage they made for him where he's just looking out from under the water.
And just some incredible editing techniques. Because the two guys are out on the boat or doing whatever. Like, the captain is below with the head of the expedition. There's another, like,
doctor
friend on the boat smoking his pipe.
And the girl.
And the girl is, like, below deck as well.
Yeah.
It keeps cutting back between the doctor in the rocking chair smoking his pipe, Gilman in this watery cage.
Just looking up.
Looking up, like, supposedly knocked out, but because he's a fish, he
still
always
has
his
eyes
open. And it cuts between the girl, too. And it does this back and forth, and then Gilman wakes up, cuts back to the guy, and then there's a sound, he grabs his gun, cuts It's the girl.
It's the girl. That's technically a false jump scare.
It is. Like, this...
Technically, it's a false scare, but it's really... It's so engaging, intense, and not...
They were learning.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Unfortunately, this led to a really crappy...
But this film was good. Let's focus on this.
This film was amazing. Like, I mean...
Had some really, like... They went there with a lot of shots. Like the shot of the hand sticking up. Like, the hand of a dead body sticking up out of a ruined tent. There was blood on it. And that scene where the...
Gilman even had some blood on him at the end.
Where the guy drowns.
Oh, yeah.
And, like, just you him, see his like, body just, like, floating up. Like, that is a freaking...
Oh. That is intense. A haunting image.
That is scary. But anyone who spent any time around water, especially open water, knows the dangers of drowning. And that's just like, whew, yeah. Oh,
but
yeah.
For all intents and purposes, this is still very much a B movie. This is a cult classic.
It is a very well-made B movie.
Like, in terms of like the cultiest of cult films, this is up there.
Yes. But I never felt like, because a lot of B-movies tend to drag in the first act, and this had a long first act, but I never felt incredibly
But it was
bored.
Justified.
Yes. And the characters never felt too stocky. They were stocky, but they weren't cardboard cutouts.
Right. Not unlike that musical that shall not be named.
But I really did like the characters in this. Even, like, the butt-faced character,
You know what?
Blonde pretty boy. He had his motives and he had his moments.
He had his motives, his moments, and his, like, redeeming moments.
Yes.
Like, he totally redeemed himself at the end. He, like, I mean, I don't even think there were even cardboard cutout characters here.
There,
like,
really weren't.
Aside from, like, the people that Gilman offs.
The red shirts.
The red shirt stand-ins who are Hispanic. Or technically Brazilian. Let's just.
Supposed to be Brazilian.
Latin America.
Latin.
We're going off topic so many times. Can we just wrap this up? Okay, you didn't know anything.
No. Oh, I really like... No. I liked the captain guy.
Yeah!
Like, the knife thing.
He like, that is asserting dominance on an expert level.
Because this is very... He's almost the comic relief character, but he's the most experienced character in that area. And there's this point when everyone else wants to get the crap out of there because Gilman's killed. And the butt-faced guy wants to stay and bag him. And then the captain, who is smiling and laughing the entire time, just puts a Bowie knife right to his chin. And he's like, I'm the captain. What I say goes. We're leaving now. And he's incredibly comic relief. But he's also, you can tell, he's the one that makes sure everything happens smoothly. And one more thing. I liked the relationship between the main girl and the main guy.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, nobody here is exactly a cardboard cutout because all the characters have some depth. They have they're not just two-dimensional. They're somewhat, probably 2.5 dimensional.
Right. It's really subtle, but in a lot of the montage shots and a lot of, like, just in the background of shots, the main girl and the main guy would just go to each other and hold each other. Like, not even when bad stuff was happening, when good stuff was happening, they were just always, like, gravitating towards each other. And it was just this fact that they were a couple and they were in it for the long haul.
So. You didn't draw anything.
No. I was eating.
You were eating. We were both kind of just really just enjoying the movie. This has a documentary on it. Like, a 40-minute documentary called Return to the Lagoon or something. We're going to watch it, possibly give our thoughts on it, maybe make it a Patreon exclusive. But, like, we're definitely going to check that out at some point. Right now, we just got to focus on the next film. Mm-hmm. But, horrifying in 1954?
Yes.
Definitely.
Yes.
Horrifying now? Definitely.
There were some parts that got palpitating.
Horrifying and entertaining and just, like, the standard of what...
Oh, my goodness.
The standard of what... Good.
A good creature movie.
Creature
would,
movies. Not so much for the next one because MST3K covered it.
I mean, creature like Jaws, Jurassic Park, like a creature.
Yeah.
A creature attacks movie.
Yeah. And
was a good one.
This was a good one. Definitely check it out. We enjoyed it.
Yes.
It's available everywhere. So yeah, this was also released in 3D. It comes in a 2D and 3D Blu-ray. So, I mean, we obviously have the creature from the Black Lagoon Legacy Collection from 2004. But if you want to check this movie out, definitely stay away from the musical. You hear my thoughts on the musical are in the description.
Gilman looks like the Predator.
Like a Rastafarian swamp thing. So, if you enjoyed this video, and I'm sure you have been watching for probably at least the last 23 minutes.
Mm-hmm. You should subscribe.
Definitely subscribe.
For more.
Our faces are right here. Subscribe. We are continuing on this little Gilman mm-hmm. trek.
Next week.
Revenge of the Creature.
Yay.
Which is one that MST3K has covered.
Which side is it on, dear?
I think it's disc 2, side 1.
No, which side of the screen is it on, dear, so I know where to point.
Oh, it's going to be the... No. Yeah, it's going to be that
way. This way.
That way.
Revenge of the Creature next week.
Like, She Wolf 11, that way. Last one we saw...
was...
No, that's next week.
Dang it!
I'm sorry! No, por qué? I know he didn't do that, but that's what it deserved. If it were made nowadays, they would have done that. But okay. Over there, it's the next video, or the next movie we're going to see, Revenge of the Creature.
Mm-hmm. Last week.
With a first in terms of a starring role. We're not going to say who, even though you probably already do now if you're a fan of Back to the Future. And last week we saw Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein, the last of the great
Monster Mashes.
Really. We, like, two good movies in a row.
Yay!
Too bad we have to ruin it.
I know.
I don't know.
That's our luck.
We may end up enjoying it.
It may be fun.
I have hope.
Hope springs eternal.
Little hope. You may need more training.
Maybe.
I got this. We got this.
You got this. You got this.
I've got it.
Shut your mouth, boy!
And like a biker chick's tattoo!
I'm gonna meet you in the booty
place. Permanently stuck on
you! Oh, you're gonna be stuck on something here.
Bye, everybody.